Feens. Studios. We alter your locus ceruleus by warming your synapses with rejuvenative radio waves. This keeps a sin flood of statism out of your brain. Can you feel it? Can you feel it, Ben Stone, the bad Quaker? Is it working? Is it working, Ben?
I have my hand on the radio and I can feel it.
Feel the healing power of the fiends coming through your radio. Yep. That's we usually have Diana do that line, but she's not on today. So Ben Stone, the bad Quaker from badquaker.com. How are you and where are you?
I am good. I am on the Gulf Coast, and it's just really nice. We had a lovely area down here that we like to come down for the winter, and my wife and I love it. We can move from campground to campground really easy and live very inexpensively.
Are you in the broadcast area of our station in Slidell, Louisiana, and New Orleans?
Not at the moment, but we plan on being there probably in January or so. So cool. I can't wait to actually hear us on real radio.
I hear us on real radio every week because I am on in my town in Wyoming, and they play us delayed. You know, they play us 2 hours after the show goes live. I was told by someone at Talkers Magazine that I am probably the only host in America that can do that, because most radio now is done either, you know, by somebody who's in New York or LA or Atlanta, and it's live, like absolutely live on their station, or it's done by people remotely from their homes like I do it, and they're not on in that town. But I actually worked really hard to get us on the radio in our town, so it's pretty cool. And they play us, they might even be playing us now, because they usually play a delayed one live if there's not sports. So let's go ahead and see. But go ahead and talk, Ben.
So here's a funny thing. I'm not sure who wrote this, but it's floating around a little bit. It says, but whether 9/11 really be the one thing or the other, this much is certain. The national government has either authorized such an attack or has been powerless to prevent it. Either way, it is unfit to exist, unfit being the national government. And that's a sort of a twisted quote from a guy named Lysander Spooner. And I'll read the real quote now. Lysander Spooner said, in reference to the United States government, he said, but whether the Constitution really be one thing or another, this much is certain, that it has either authorized such government as we have had, or it has been powerless to prevent it. In either case, it is unfit to exist.
Yeah, and it's kind of interesting that people, and we like Lysander Spooner. We are big fans, and that was written in the late 1800s. And he was, he knew some of the founding fathers. Wait, were they dead by then? No, he knew some of the town masters of Philadelphia, didn't he?
Yeah, most of the actual founding fathers were dead by the time he was born, but yeah. He was right in that area.
Yeah, but he was arrested for practicing law without a license, even though he was such a good lawyer that people kept going to him over and over and over. And Congress enacted an act against him. He basically, and this is proof that the government doesn't want competition. They don't want the free market doing things better, even when they're losing money doing the thing. Because he created a post office which delivered between three or four cities. And, you know, there pretty much only were three or four cities back then. I think it delivered between like Philadelphia, Washington, D.C., New York City and Boston, something like that.
And Baltimore, I believe.
Yeah. And he delivered, you know, stamped postal mail, you know, letters. I don't think he did packages, but he did letters cheaper and better than the post office. And the post office got Congress to pass a law that it's illegal to compete with the U.S. government and deliver mail for less than they do, which is one of the reasons UPS and FedEx cost more than the post office.
And keep this in mind, too. At the time, if I recall, it cost something like, this is before Lysander Spooner started competing with him. It cost something like 25 cents to mail a letter from New York City to like Boston.
That was a fortune back then.
It was 25 cents. There were people that weren't earning that in a day.
Yeah.
And Lysander Spooner came in and started delivering for a nickel. And the other thing that he did was he started making deliveries to people's businesses and homes. And in the at that time, post office, the U.S. Postal Service only delivered to post offices.
And you had to pick it up.
Yeah, you had to go down there and tell them your name and tell them, you know, have them then walk back and look and see if they had mail for you.
Yeah.
And Lysander Spooner actually delivered it right to the customer, which forced the mail service to lower the prices and begin a home delivery of mail, which they had never done in the past.
Wow. Yeah, man. Governments are square. They get in the way. You know, anytime a government, the things that politicians say, I almost universally laugh at, except when they're so horrible. Like, you know, when the police throw a flashbang into a baby's crib and the police walk scot-free and the police say things like, well, those people were terrorists because they had drugs, like basically blaming their own terrorism on the people that they were terrorizing and they didn't find the drugs they were looking for. You know, when some politician says that he backs that, you know, that makes me horrified. But most of what they say makes me laugh. And one of the things that makes me laugh the hardest is when any politician, Democrat or Republican, talks about using government to stimulate the economy or make jobs. Because everything governments do does the exact opposite by design.
You know, we had to suffer through the elections here not long ago, and down here in southern Alabama near the Florida border, it unfortunately, and I don't watch much TV, but my wife likes to watch her shows that she likes, and unfortunately, being on the Florida Alabama border, you get political ads for two sets of goons running for two different states. And so we got to hear, you know, all these different politicians blaming the incumbent for the bad economy. And then the incumbent trying to take credit for the slight uptick in jobs that's happened in the last 6 or 8 months or whatever it is. And it's so funny. No, the politicians, the state politicians especially, have absolutely no influence on you know, creating jobs unless they get out of the way. Getting out of the way kind of helps business a little bit, but mostly they can't do that. It's not their nature to get out of the way. It's the nature of politicians, whether Democrat or Republican, to seek more power, because power corrupts and more power corrupts more. And it creates a desire for more and more power, the more of it that you get.
Yeah. And politicians at the federal level are very large percentage of them are attorneys. You know, that's what they that's the aspiration path. You know, people become attorneys and then they get involved in politics as an attorney and then they work up to running for office. At the state level, and especially you know, at the local state level, like state reps, they are largely people who have run businesses, which, you know, would some people, that's what they run under. Like, my opponent is an attorney. He's only existed in academia. He doesn't understand the real market. But also you end up with people that understand nothing about economics and they're not terribly skilled or educated. In Wyoming, there's a name for them. It's ranch slaters. And not saying anything bad about ranchers, but you should see some of the bills that are written in Wyoming by the ranch slaters. And they actually write the bills, which, you know, if you're going to say you like government, I guess you'd like that better than something written by a team of lobbyist attorneys, but like a lot of things at the federal level. But I mean, some of these things have typos in them. Like, they go to the floor for a vote and become law with typos in them and ill-formed sentences. And the I guess the saving grace, which is kind of like saying I'd rather be punched in the throat than slashed in the belly. The saving grace is that they tend to be really short, like a page or three, and they tend to be in fairly plain English. So aside from the fact that the plain English is often poorly written and kind of trying to look like legalese but isn't, you can actually read the bills here, and it's kind of fun. I mean, I used to do it because I cared and was trying to be involved, you know, like 6 years ago. But now I read them for entertainment purposes. And it's amazing the things that get passed. You know, I mean, there was actually Wyoming had really strong castle doctrine. You know, the law that says, or the set of laws that basically say, if someone breaks into your home, you can shoot them. With some exceptions, you know, of course, they always put in police officers, and they don't even say if the police officers are acting legally or morally. But they have, you know, they had pretty good castle doctrine here. And then you know, the governor got involved, the incoming governor, and said, we need to strengthen castle doctrine. And they ended up passing an addendum to it that actually weakened it. And, like, people didn't really notice. I mean, some people noticed, like Anthony Bouchard from the Wyoming Gun Owners Association. You know, he reads the bills and understands them and posts a newsletter of what's wrong with them. But most people just said, oh, that governor ran by saying he likes guns. And, you know, the guy is a former federal attorney. He's on the side of the federal government, you know.
You know, MK Lords, one of the co-hosts here on the show, wrote a really good article, and you can find it at, I believe it's Anarchy Today. No, dailyanarchist.com. There it is.
Dailyanarchist.com. Yeah, which is a site that is Davi Barker. Do you know Davi Barker, one of our other co-hosts, is the editor of that?
I had forgot that, but yeah.
And when we say anarchist, we're not talking about communists who want to blow stuff up. We're talking about people who are basically, you know how Republicans say, some Republicans say, I want government so small it can be drowned in a bathtub. And that's, you know, they say that when they're running for office. But then once they're elected, they act like Bill Clinton in a lot of ways. So, but we're, you know, when we say anarcho-capitalist, we're not violent. We do carry guns, but we're not violent. We're not aggressing. We're not blowing up property. And we don't want to take your stuff. We want to save you from government with our minds, with education, and teach you that. You should want a government that's so small, it's theorized about by particle physicists. So what article did she write?
I can't remember the name of it, but it was about voting.
Well, that's helpful.
Why. Yeah. Well, if you go over there.
I will go over there. What's it about? Okay. Before we go to the break, what's it about?
It's about voting and the results of the recent voting.
Ah, okay. Yeah. So Lysander Spooner, sum it up real quick here.
Yeah, so Lysander Spooner, and, you know, to quote Boston Tea Party, if you really, really love the Constitution, just remember it was written by the founding lawyers.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Worms.
You and the hamster in your brain are listening to Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean and his weird friends.
Having outgrown childish libertarian fantasies, I now believe in worms! What is Libertarians Against Humanity? It's the only unofficial Cards Against Humanity expansion pack by libertarians, for libertarians, and against libertarians. Libertarians Against Humanity is free to play online, or join the Indiegogo campaign to get physical copies and other perks to play with friends or status you haven't defued yet. Because if we don't laugh, the status win.
Not recommended for faint heart, thin skins, or those who easily rustle jimmies. Consult a physician if you experience drop blood pressure or laughter last longer than 4 hours.
That's libertariansagainsthumanity.com.
Freedom Fiends talking to Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker. And Ben is an older gentleman, and he does have brain farts from time to time, and we love him. And I'm not making fun of his age. He's actually also had about 30 concussions in his life, largely because before he worked in aerospace, he worked as, let's say, a private collections man for a group of motorcycle enthusiasts, and the job description involved, well, you've been shot a few times, right? Twice or once, I forget.
Yeah, I've been shot twice. I've been shot at a few times.
Yeah,
when they didn't hit me.
But. Yeah. So Ben's brain works like a locomotive that occasionally just stops in between two towns for no reason. And the name of the article on the on dailyanarchist.com by MK Lords is called the anarchist case against cannabis legalization. Now, this is written by a woman who is entirely in favor of, you know, there's nothing wrong with people smoking pot and they should be able to do it. But it's making the case that legalizing it involves the government in ways that make things worse. I will link the article in the show notes today. But the, you know, the crux, I mean, an example I can see is in Colorado, where they've legalized marijuana statewide, but not federally. First of all, the feds are still going in and busting, and even more than they used to, going in and busting dispensaries and grow operations. But also, they're adding so many layers of taxation and regulation that legal marijuana costs more than black market marijuana. And people are going to the black market now who weren't before when it's legal.
A really good thing that she points out in that article, too, is that, you know, you always hear this phrase coming from that side that says, let's tax it and regulate it, which anybody with half a brain ought to just start shivering when they hear that statement. So they tax it. And then what are they going to do with that tax money? They're going to pay for more police to come in and bother you for other things. Yeah. Or the actual enforcement upon the black market side of the exact same thing, like what you mentioned there in Colorado, where people are being forced to go to the black market because the legal stuff is so expensive. Well, the people that are paying for the legal stuff are paying for the enforcement against the black market to make it worse.
You know why machine guns are illegal in America? For the most part, without a, you know, in a few states, you can get a government stamp and have them give them the right to search your house anytime and pay, you know, $15,000 for a machine gun that would cost, $800 in semi-auto version. You know why that is, Ben?
I've assumed it was because of scary gangster movies from the late 20s and early 30s that panicked people and made the excuse to outlaw them.
Well, it's because of alcohol prohibition, you know, and the same thing, here's what I'm saying. Ben and I don't smoke the drugs. We don't take the drugs. But nope. Anybody listening who does not smoke the drugs but likes the guns should still be against any government involvement in outlawing or regulating or taxing drugs, because they lead to the war on guns. They lead to your guns being taken away. And, you know, some people would say, gun owners would be like, well, who would need a machine gun? If you say that, why should anyone have a machine gun? Anybody who says that is brainwashed. To some extent, because you should be able to have, you know, an honest person should be able to have any weapon they want as long as they don't use it violently, against their neighbor. You know, there's a phrase that I really like that's used by hardcore gun people like us and by, you know, I haven't heard Boston Tea Party use it, but or Bill Buford use it. Maybe Bill uses this, but I've definitely heard Mike Vandebau and David Kadria, you know, from Sipsy Street Irregular site and the War on Guns blog. And those are the two guys who broke the scandal about the, you know, the ATF giving weapons, letting cartels get armed and then trying to track the guns and then failing to do so and then getting some agents killed. The Gunwalker scandal. So the phrase they use for hunters who think there should be limitations on guns because it doesn't affect their hunting, they call them FUDs after Elmer Fudd.
That's pretty good. Another thing about that, though, is the war against drugs is actually a war against property, because if they can say you can own this property, but you can't own that property, then it's just a matter of time until they can decide any particular property, whether it's a giant jumbo size cola or whether it's a gun or whether
or
it's
keeping
a weed.
Or warming your house to above a survival rate like they have in England.
Yeah, exactly.
And in England, they actually, if you have a house that you own in England and you have a spare bedroom and don't rent it out, you have to pay tax on that spare bedroom. Ugh. We'll be back. Yuck.
Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean. This is what radio sounds like now.
Now that the elections are over and liberty has slipped even further away, it's time to try yet another political organization. Campaign for a Longer Leash is a nonpartisan group of pups and dogs dedicated to fighting for longer leashes for all. We're not talking about no leashes. That would be catarchy. We just want the limited leash that the Hounding Fathers promised us. As Bone Barklin once said, a longer leash if you can keep it, ma'am. For more info, go to facebook.com/campaignforalongerleash.
And Ben's going to talk a bit and review something. Yeah.
Yeah. One of our listeners sent me an email and said, hey, Ben, check this video out. It's called Engine of Domination, and it's by a guy named Mark Korske, C-O-R-S-K-E. And you can find this on YouTube. It's about an hour long video, and he does a really good job on it. The basic premise is that that the need for government is an invention of mankind. It is not natural to mankind. It's like farming or the axe or any other tool. It's a tool that is actually used by one small group of people to enslave everybody else or to domesticate them. And so I have a little review that I actually wrote this review, so I'll just read it verbatim here. Engine of Domination. From a technical point of view, the beginning duologue seems a bit stiff. Now, that said, quality voice actors are not cheap, and they did a better job than I could have done, so my criticism on that point is weak. On the other hand, the overall presentation was very good. The analogy that they used of the elite simply being people who developed government as an engine of control was very good. I think Korske presents an excellent argument that dominant government is not an aspect of human nature. Government is simply a tool developed to domesticate humans into slavery. I think the only part of the video that I have a problem with was near the end. He seems to lean towards the Marxist-Leninist view of property and the Marxist-Leninist view of the solution being lassoing government and simply outlawing domination.
Ew.
Basically,
well,
that
I'm not
is
saying,
using...
And, you know, statists would hear me say that, especially liberals, and say, he just said ew to outlawing domination. He wants the strong to be able to violate the weak. No, and that is a common rubric, you know, a common falseness, a straw man that is thrown at us all the time. Like if we say we're against Obamacare, they say, oh, you're against healthcare. You must be stupid. And if you say, you know, I'm against gun laws, they say you want violence and blood in the streets. No, that's called a straw man. And you should learn to recognize that. It's used all the time in arguments. Straw man is based on the idea of that they used to do bayonet training with, you know, a man, like a scarecrow filled with straw. And the idea of a straw man argument is replacing your valid argument with a similar sounding invalid argument, invalidating the invalid argument and claiming they've won.
Yeah, and that's really common. That's a real common thing that they use against us. The other problem I had with that movie was that, you know, so essentially he's saying use government to fix government. And we know how that works, right? That's silly. And then the other problem I have with it is that he seems close to the end. He seems to be saying that that we need to outlaw weapons, specifically government weapons, and that this would somehow make governments acceptable. But that's like, when did a prohibition ever work? When has that ever worked? And when did it ever work to make government fix government? And when did it ever work to shrink government or to limit or restrict government? I mean, that's what Lysander Spooner was talking about, that we talked about in earlier segment. If you expect that writing something on a piece of paper is going to limit government, then you've put more faith in a piece of paper than it really needs to be there. So I think that's where this movie falls apart. But the whole rest of the movie is well worth sitting the hour through it. Engine of Domination by Mark Korske. It's overall a pretty good movie. He lays out a really good argument, but just the solution of just, you know, wishful thinking of assuming that if we just tell government to stop being mean, then they'll suddenly all of a sudden, oh, okay, you don't like being a slave? Well, I guess we'll turn you loose now.
Yeah.
So I should kind of give an overview of the thing. The main point of the movie is that government is a tool developed by humans. It's not an aspect of human nature. And just because it was developed by humans doesn't mean it was good. I've got an example of that. Is the practice of bloodletting. Bloodletting was a medical procedure that was commonly used for over 2,500 years. And it was considered to be a proven medical solution for a wide range of ailments, everything from blood diseases to fevers to, you know, they pretty much bleed you for anything.
And sometimes they use leeches to automate it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But using the scientific method, William Harvey disproved the basis of the practice in 1628. But bloodletting was still considered a viable medical practice and was included in English medical textbooks as late as 1923. So, I mean, even when something like this is disproven, the faithful still hold on to it and grasp it. So, you know, government is not a natural aspect of the human experience. It is a thing that was developed by a very small group of people so that they could maintain control over all of the rest of us and milk us like cattle.
Yeah.
Is that too harsh?
No, man. Nope.
Herbert Spencer and actually in Tolstoy also made pretty much the same argument that government is not an aspect of human nature and that it is unnatural to the human condition and that it's actually bad for humans.
I'm amazed how much people have been brainwashed to think that central planning by governments is a good thing. You know, when some politician who's a decent orator and has some personality and a nice tie and a nice haircut gets up on a podium and they have the red, white, and blue, either bunting, you know, if it's at a county fair, or, animations if it's on Fox News. People believe that stuff, man, from the left and the right. They believe it when people say, there's a problem and my administration will fix it. First of all, the problem is caused by government. Almost all the problems that they're promising to fix are caused by government. Different government isn't going to be the solution. And historically, it never is. You know, I mean, you think about the removal of rights for the common man over the decades and centuries in America. You know, it just gets worse and worse and worse. I mean, you know, just look at gun rights. Up until a certain point in the 30s, you could mail order a machine gun for $29 from the Sears and Roebuck catalog. You weren't forced to get health care you didn't want. You weren't forced to lose the health care you liked. You know, you didn't have to pay a property tax, which is a rent on something you own, and the thing will be stolen if you don't pay it. You could travel freely. You didn't need license plates. I'm not saying everything was better back then, and I do point out the fallacy of people who say they want to get back to when America was good, you know, which I've put a lot of thought into when that point would be, because people never really say when they talk about restoring the Republic. And it's usually either right after the signing of the Declaration of Independence. Well, no, it's usually 1776, if they don't know history, which 1776, there was a violent war going on. People were dying in the streets. There was blood in the streets. You know, people were dying who were innocent, who didn't want any part of the battle and didn't have an opinion on it. And really, if people want to say, I want to go back to, you know, if they're saying they want to go back to when America stood up to King George, they should go back to 1775, which is when that started. And, you know, if you want to say, well, maybe right after the Revolutionary War, well, that would be, you know, when George Washington in the Whiskey Rebellion murdered Revolutionary War vets who had fought beside him and under him for not paying a whiskey tax that was much higher than the tax they'd fought the British over. Or the time they seem to really want to go back to, if they're 50 years old like me or older, they seem to want to go back to Leave It to Beaver. They want to go back to somewhere between, let's see, the end of, like, right after World War II and right before the hippies, you know, somewhere between like 1946 and 1963, I think, you know, which was segregation and what else? I guess, you know, it was a horrible time for some people, but it was a good time for other people because it really was the first time America had just kind of unbridled growth and, you know, somebody working 40 hours a week could buy a house and support a family of four and buy an automobile and buy nice things in shiny catalogs for the first time. And I really think that life is better now. I mean, I like Amazon better than Sears and Roebuck in the 50s. You know, you can get everything you want in 25 different colors delivered overnight, you know, and that's kind of the government getting out of the way in a way, because the internet and the government's trying to rein it in. They're trying, the FCC's trying to get involved, which is ridiculous, but they're trying to rein it in and say, oh, the internet's like the Wild West. And actually, despite what you see in cowboy movies, a lot of things function in the Wild West better than they do now with less violence.
Yeah, the Wild West was nowhere near as wild as people have imagined due to Hollywood. There was a professor in Dayton, Ohio, who did a study a couple years back on bank robberies during the 1800s. And he found out that there were more bank robberies in Dayton, Ohio in that year. I think this was like 2011 or 2012 or something. There were more bank robberies in Dayton, Ohio that year than happened in the entire United States from something like 1870 to 1900 or something like that.
Yeah, well, in the Wild West, most people in a bank were armed. And if you robbed a bank, you had a good chance of getting shot. And a really common kind of bank robbery right now is like robbing those little outlet ones in supermarkets where there's nobody with a gun, you know?
Yeah.
There's no guard, and there and those people, I'm not saying do it, but I'm saying people generally walk out of there with the money and get in their car and drive away. They may get caught later, but you know, those people are instructed, give up the money if you get robbed. And who, even if they're not instructed that, who wouldn't do that? You know, who's making minimum wage or, you know, maybe 1.5 times minimum wage is going to risk their life for someone else's insured money when a gun's pointed at them? They'd be insane to do it, to be a hero.
And another thing in history, most people don't realize that back in the 1800s, that money belonged to the town, to the townspeople that were right there. They had to not only get out of the bank, they had to get out of the town, which is why the Dalton gangs mostly died in Coffeyville, and the Younger and James gangs died in, was it Northfield, I believe? Yeah, Northfield, Minnesota. Anyway, that's why they died there, because once they got out of the bank, the townspeople shot them to pieces.
Yeah. Then there was the Sundance Kid, which he's named after Sundance, Wyoming. It's kind of funny because people think that the Sundance Film Festival is in Wyoming, but no, it's in Utah, and it's named after the actor was in the movie Sundance Kid. Yeah. What's the actor? Red-haired guy.
I'm old.
You're listening to The Freedom Fiends, an invigorating alternative to those other shows.
Do you believe in free speech? Jay Raven had her True Shives YouTube channel taken down. We believe this censorship was wrong, and we believe the channel is a clear example of free speech. Many people are bullied on the internet, but Jay Raven actually stood up to the bullying. She has filed a self-defense lawsuit against the individuals who took down the channel. The outcome of this suit could be very important to the future of free speech. Learn more at trueshibes.com. That's Tango, Romeo, Uniform, Sierra, Hotel, India, Bravo, Echo, Sierra.com. Trueshibes.com.
Are you tired of your taxes funding endless occupations around the world? Antiwar.com is run by people who understand that wars abroad become wars at home, wars on our freedoms. Antiwar.com is dedicated to bringing you the latest in news, views, interviews, and reviews from the top movers and shakers in the anti-occupation movement. Antiwar.com has it all, from thorough foreign policy analysis to interviews with whistleblowers who used to run the military-industrial complex. Antiwar, pro-free market. That's Antiwar.com.
Titillating your brain lobes since 2011. Robert Redford started the Sundance Film Festival, and he played.
We are old.
Well, we should know that because we're old. Like, young people wouldn't know that. But Robert Redford and Paul Newman played, respectively, the Sundance Kid and Butch Cassidy. And Robert Redford started the Sundance Film Festival, which is in Park City, Utah. I've actually been to it. I went to it in like 2004, maybe. I was in the Lost Film Festival, which is one of the, it's a traveling film festival, tiny one that, you know, a lot of Sundance Film Festival is so successful that a bunch of other film festivals have started up that kind of ride on its coattails and happen in the same town at the same time. But instead of lush theaters, they're in like coffee shops and bars and things like that. And I had fun. I showed my movie to, you know, 20. I spent a bunch of money and flew from Los Angeles to go freeze and have to buy winter clothing because I didn't have any because I was in Los Angeles to, you know, stay in a hotel that I got bed bugs. No, I got scabies from and had to get medicine from a doctor. It was out of town. It was like it was all the good hotels were booked up. So I stayed wherever I could and took a tram in or a little bus, a little short bus. Yeah. So Sundance Kid, the original Sundance Kid, the real one is named after Sundance, Wyoming. But yeah, the Sundance Film Festival is not in Wyoming. So there.
So I learned something new today. I thought it was in
Did you really?
Sundance, Wyoming. Yeah.
You really did?
Yeah. I never really checked it out or thought much about it. I just assumed that's where it was.
Wow. Huh.
Amazing.
Yeah. And you're a smart guy. It would make sense. It sounds like it would be. And then there's this whole convoluted backstory of, no, it was started by Robert Redford and he named it after, you know, he played a cowboy and it was kind of he played a bank robbing cowboy, played a Robin cowboy, a bad, I don't know. Well, Hollywood's painted them well, but you know, he played a highwayman. And I guess that was like his, I don't know if it was his biggest role, but I guess it was like that, the Sundance Defining. Film Festival. Yeah. It's kind of a rogue film festival, you know, cause at the time when it started, it's a big industry thing now, but when it started, it was kind of shocking for a major Hollywood star to start this little independent film fest in this sleepy little mountain town, you know, like people leave LA and not go to Cannes Film Festival. You know, like why would people in LA travel in the, you know, to go freeze in a little mountain town in a state they've never been to that seems, you know, rural and bizarre and backwoods, but then people did it and really liked it and found it charming and all the little shops. And it's a weird town because it's kind of like driven on the economy in a large way of skiing, but also of the film festival that's, you know, 7 days or 8 days or whatever once a year. And, that's why that's one of those tiny little mountain towns in Utah where things cost a lot more than they should. And you can buy sushi.
You know, Paul Newman and Robert Redford starred in another movie that I always liked a lot more than Butch Cassidy and Sundance Kid. That was The Sting. And I don't think The Sting got as big as Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, but I always enjoyed watching it more. I can go back and watch The Sting over and over and over. I really like that movie.
I like the music. I like the song.
The music was cool, too. I think the most that I liked about the movie was that it gave the opportunity to see how certain cons work. And it's that, as a kid, that stimulated my mind thinking, so that's how that does. That's why people react the way they do. And I learned a lot about it. It stimulated me to find out how cons work. And so, like, as a teenager, I found that fascinating. And I talked to the right people and found out as much as possible about how cons work. By the time I was like 18, 19, I could pull a pretty good con if I wanted to on someone.
Yeah.
Which is not something probably to brag about, but it was fun and entertaining and profitable.
Yeah.
So the movies are good for something, but, you know, probably not what they meant for.
Movies are good. I like movies a lot. I like movies a lot. And I'm on the radio saying, I like movies a lot. It's kind of interesting, though, now that anybody can make one. A lot of crap's come out, but a lot of really great stuff has come out, too. You know, there's some filmmaker in the 60s said something that film will only truly become an art form when the materials become as cheap as pencil and paper. And I think we're at that point.
There's some really good independent movies on YouTube that people have just put together on a dime.
Some of them are shot on cell phones.
Isn't that amazing?
Yes.
What a time to be alive, Ben.
Worms. We'll be back with hour two of the Freedom Fiends after this trip to the free market and some national news. It'll probably scare the heck out of you, and then we'll come back and make you feel better and hopeful. Worms.
This show survives on donations from fiends like you. We put that money back into our show and Liberty Outreach and donate most of our ad space to Liberty organizations that make a difference. We're also a teaching hospital, educating the next generation of Liberty talkers on the skills needed to keep the radio flame of truth burning into the future. Put your money where your heart is and make a donation of any amount to the Freedom Fiends. Please go to freedomfiends.com and click on the spinning coin on any post.
Creamy Radio Audio. Want caviar sound on a cat food budget? Creamy Radio Audio by the Freedom Fiends has great free tips so you can sound like a pro without spending like one. The most powerful form of human communication is one person speaking to another. But if people have to suffer through your sound, they'll change the channel and miss your message. With articles on microphones, preamps, recorders, mastering, recording remotely over the internet, doing a podcast, even getting a show on actual radio, the Freedom Fiends show you what they use and where to get it. Whether you're a talk show host, voiceover artist, podcaster, evangelist, or just want to record your loved ones for the ages, at Creamy Radio Audio, the Freedom Fiends will help you make the most of your sound. Creamy Radio Audio will help you speak to the world with sound that will make people want to keep listening. Check out creamyradioaudio.com. That's creamyradioaudio.com.
This is the Freedom Fiends, broadcasting through the Libertarian Reindoctrination Center's low orbit ion cannon, high atop Financial Beast Plaza on the artificial satellite LibPair 2017 in the Alpha Centauri region. I'm your host, Michael W. Dean. And we have with us today Mr. Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker from badquaker.com. Are you there, Ben? Are you there? Have you been contacted by the government? Are you safe?
I'm safe. I have not been contacted by the government. I'm kind of hard to find these days. On purpose.
Yeah, they could find you if they wanted to, but...
We haven't mentioned, though, that Obama is a liar and a socialist and his feet stink.
Oh, yeah. Yep. And that's a quote from my 93-year-old dad, but I like it. It's him being really polite. Like, he won't cuss. And I asked him on air one time what he thought of Obama, and he said... He's a liar. He said, Barack Obama is a liar. He's a socialist and his feet stink. And I like it. It was quaint and to the point. And then Neem of Adati and I took a sample of him saying that, made a hip hop song out of it. And you can hear that song if you go to YouTube and search Obama's feet stink. And
go ahead.
It's not radio friendly. So I'm just going to tell you to go find Obama's feet stink. If you're of legal age to hear some cuss words in your area, you can do that.
That's one of those phrases, one of those insults that people used to throw around back in the day that's kind of lost a lot of
your
its meaning.
Your feet stink?
Yeah. Yeah. I strongly suspect it was an indication that you were a homeless type person, or as they used to say back in the 20s and 30s, you were a bum.
Yeah.
Because if you're, let's see, I think it was Neil Young that has a line in a song about people sleeping with their shoes on. But if you are homeless and you are sleeping on the street... You sleep with your shoes on. You do not take your shoes off because somebody will steal them.
Yeah, they'll steal them, or, you know, when you're sleeping rough or sleeping outside, sleeping rough, as they say, you never know when someone you're going to suddenly wake up with someone trying to harm you and have to run away, and you don't want to have to gather your things.
Exactly. So that I think that was probably, I'm not saying for certain, and it's just a wild guess, but that was probably an insult back in the 20s and 30s, much like, you know, your mother wears army boots.
There's actually a hidden meaning with your mother wears combat boots. Most people think that means your mother is masculine, but what it actually means, it's implying that your mother, you know, is selling her body to soldiers.
Yeah, she's friendly with the troops.
Yeah, that's what it meant. Yeah, I used to kind of live rough for a lot of my life. I was kind of homeless and couch surfing in between homes a lot. And, you know, now I'm not. I'm settled. I'm happy. But I was happy then, too, to an extent. And one of the things I realized early on was I had been a Boy Scout. And there's the Boy Scout packing rule. When you pack for a camping trip, You know, basically being homeless means you're camping somewhere every night, even if it's in a on someone's couch. So the Boy Scout packing rule, it's really useful in life in general, is take the absolute minimum you can spend, you could get through your trip with. Put it on your bed, look at it all, and then pack half of what's on your bed. And that's a really good methodology, not only for packing for a camping trip, but for travel or for being homeless. Or it's also kind of a good analogy for life, for simplifying things. And I'm not saying, you know, live without, but, you know, an example is my wife and I share one car. And because we share one car and live somewhere that's not expensive to live in Wyoming, we live really well. Like we almost never worry about bills. We're not rich, but we never worry. And a lot of it is because we share one car. Most people, most 50-year-old men would say, I have to have my own car. But I work at home. And, you know, a lot of times if we have to go somewhere, it's on the weekend, we go together, or I take the car on my own. And the rare occasion that I have to be somewhere that requires a car that I can't walk to or ride a bicycle to, and I like riding a bicycle. You know, a lot of people say, you're 50 and you ride a bike, you loser. No, I'm 50 and I ride a bike sometimes, and it's healthy, you know, and it's fun. And, you know, if I have to go to the dentist, like the dentist is 5 blocks away, I'll walk there. But if I have to go somewhere during the day when she's working in an office and I'm working at home, you know, I take a taxi like 2 or 3 times a year, that comes up. And doing that instead of owning a car, I mean, think about how much money not owning a second car saves us. You know, it's an inordinate amount of money. It's the difference between getting by well and not getting by and struggling. So that's kind of the Boy Scout packing rule in action. And the Boy Scout packing rule came in really handy one time when I was living in DC and I was living with this woman. I was back when I was drinking. I've been sober for 20 years now, but everything I owned fit in a messenger bag at the time. And this is before messenger bags were hip. I had been a bike messenger. That's why I had a messenger bag. And she got mad at me and threw me out one day in the evening. Like, I don't care where you go. You're going, you're leaving. And I was drunk and I was like, you can't throw me out. I'm the luckiest boy in the world. And she grabbed my messenger bag and packed my few possessions into it, stuck it into my hands and said, there you go, luckiest boy in the world. Get out. And I said, well, I don't know where I'm going to go. And she's like, not my problem. I opened the door and there was a guy I'd never seen standing there with his hand up about to knock on the door. And he said, oh, hi, is Michael here? And I said, ah, I'm Michael. And he said, oh, I'm a friend of your friend, Little Mike's. He told me I should, Little Mike is someone I knew from San Francisco. This is in DC. And he said, I'm a friend of Little Mike's. We went to high school together. He said, I should look you up and go party with you. And I said, cool. Can I stay at your house tonight? And he's like, sure. And, you know, I left and the woman just looked really mad because I had just proved that I was the luckiest boy in the world.
Luckiest boy in the world.
Yeah.
You know, that's a good point that you had there. My wife and I only have one car. Of course, you know, we live in our RV. We're full-time RVers. And so we kind of move around the country and see different sites and different solve places.
Mysteries.
Different.
You drive around the country in a van solving mysteries like the Scooby-Doo gang.
With a dog. And so we have a tow-behind car with us, or in the language of the RVers, we have a toad. And because here's the thing with a toad. Unless you're like really rich, you don't want to have a really nice car being towed behind your RV.
Yeah.
Because if you're in any kind of an accident, that car is going to take the brunt of it. It's probably going to come at you from behind.
Take the brunt of it. Yeah, it's the bumper to protect you.
Exactly. So, and the other thing is, even with the best technology available as far as mud flaps and things like that, there's always going to be rocks hitting that car back behind you if it's that close. So you want to just kind of have a junker car back there. And so we have, mechanically, it's pretty reliable, but it's just an older, you know, an older Ford that we can afford to lose it at any particular time that we need to.
You offered to lend it to me for Porkfest and we rented a car instead.
Yeah, because once we got to thinking about it.
Even though we couldn't really afford to, we did anyway.
It probably wouldn't have lived through the mileage of being used that much. It's pretty much just for emergencies.
Yeah.
But we follow that, you know. I do have my Harley is still in the is in my garage in my house in Ohio where my son lives, But you know, it's not really practical to take a highway, a Harley on the highway like this in this kind of a lifestyle. But we have sold our other vehicles. We're down to that one car. And I don't think there's, you know, other than some silly ego type of a thing or some kind of macho ego thing, I don't think there's a logical reason for us to own more than one vehicle, even if we live conventionally in a house.
Yeah.
It just doesn't make sense to pay all the extra expenses.
Yeah. You know, I guess younger couples who have a lot of different things going on different sides of town at the same time, like, you know, a young couple living in LA who are both like, you know, trying to be ambitious and do things in the industry where they can get called at any time and have to go someplace, that kind of stuff, it makes sense. Or, you know, if you both work on opposite ends of town in offices or at job sites, you know, and you're one of you's not working at home, or if you're not both retired, as in your situation, yeah, it would make sense. But I like it. And you know, the thing is though, like I thought at first, like, well, we need to have two cars, and you know, we ended up selling one of them when it got really old and didn't buy a new one. So there you go. It's the Boy Scout packing rule in life.
Yeah. You know, we were talking about Obama there a minute ago too, and there's a common argument that has been thrown at me is the reason things can't work without a government is because we need leaders. We have to have leadership. And if you don't have government, who's going to decide who's the leaders? And if we don't have voting, how are we going to figure out who's leadership? And these different variations of this argument have been thrown at me over and over and over through the years. And I just want to point out that in addition to Obama being a socialist and a liar and his feet stink, he's also not a leader.
Yeah.
Barack Obama is not a leader. Leaders do not have to force you to, you know, have to, they don't need force to be a leader. They don't need force. They don't need lies. They don't need sleight of hand tricks. A true leader, people choose to associate themselves and trust the decisions of that leader. But it's entirely a matter of voluntary choice. It is not something that that society has voted on and now you're forced to live with it whether you like it or not. That's not leadership. There's nothing about leadership that fits that.
Yeah.
And the other fallacy that has been thrown at me often is, you know, it goes like this. If we don't have government, we don't have leaders. And leaders have brought us great things like electricity and the light bulb and telephones. And no, they didn't. Leaders didn't provide any of those things. And the government certainly didn't provide any of those things.
Yeah.
But that's just a fallacy that is thrown out so often that it's I heard it just the other day when a friend of mine named Becky Akers was on a different radio program. And that was the best argument that the host of the radio program could throw at her, was that we have to have leaders. How would we choose leaders? And that's just a really sad argument. That's what you say when you haven't thought things through.
Yeah. And then every once in a while you hear these ideas of the way the leaders are chosen isn't right. You know, they're hacking the voting boxes. We need to audit this. And first of all, if you audit it, the government who's doing it, if they're doing it, is going to be auditing it. Secondly, I'm not saying I like a system where things are broken and corrupt, but I'm saying fixing that is kind of like, oh, let's say you have a house that's about to collapse and you say it needs a paint job. You know, it's not addressing the root. And it's encouraging them. When you say things like, this system is sacred, we need to make sure it works ethically, you are shooting yourself in the foot by going along with a slavery system, by encouraging it, by saying it's worth fixing. And I would discourage people from giving it that much credence.
Yeah.
We'll be right back after this trip to the market. The free market.
You're listening to Freedom Fiends. So much truth, it hurts.
Hey, there's some Squiskar Squiggles from Death Clocks. And you are listening to the Freedoms Fiends on the you know, the radios. And I guess it says worms now, so there you go.
You've read books, attended lectures, and you know the Constitution well enough to know it's a well-crafted blueprint to create an ever-increasing federal empire. But there's still one thing missing.
Buttons!
Freedom Fiends now has buttons. You'll get state speech is hate speech, guns and weed, buy sheep for sheep on sheep, and two designs for the Freedom Fiends. Wear them with pride. Use them to start conversations with statists. It's only $10 for 5 buttons, including shipping. Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the link at the top that says buttons.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network, a collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
Hi, Ben.
Hey, Michael.
So, what?
I started to say it's good to be on the radio with you.
Yeah. I want to talk a little, you want to talk a little bit about the interview I did yesterday with Boston Tea Party, Bill Buepert, and Ernie Hancock. And it was actually recorded, show's usually live, but that one was actually recorded last week, one evening. It was actually Ernie called me. I think they'd been tippling some libertarian juices, and he called me and said, I just saw this video you made that I'm still not going to admit whether I had anything to do with it or not, but it kind of sounds like me voicing it in an English accent. This video about Stefan Molyneux, it kind of, Ernie said it summed him up in 90 seconds or something like that. And he asked me, like, is he really that bad? I want you to come on my show and talk about it. And I said, yeah, he's that bad. And I don't want to come on your show because your show's at 7 a.m. and I'm always asleep at 7 a.m. because I do a nighttime show during the week. And he, you know, he was like, okay. And I sleep in on the weekends and do the show. Well, it's sleep in for me. But I said, why don't we do a show right now? You three are not in the same room very often and you're sitting in a radio studio. Let's do it. And we did it. And it came out really well, and was kind of astonishingly fun and funny, and you know, Ernie talking over everybody and them trying to grab the mic from him and them yelling in the background when he muted their mic and them finally winning. And then I think Ernie and Bill's wife shuffled them away from the microphone, like the designated drivers, for the last 20 minutes. And it was just Boston laying down solid, solid truth for the last 20 minutes. It was great, man.
And just in case some of our listeners don't know who these people are that we're talking about, I want to say something about, first off, about Ernie. Ernest Hancock runs a show out of Phoenix, Arizona called Freedom's Phoenix. Freedom's with an S, Phoenix.
Now, the website is called, I make that mistake a lot too. The website is called Freedom's Phoenix. The show is called Declare Your Independence with Ernie Hancock.
Oh, you're right. That's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So freedomsphoenix.com is the website. This last Pork Fest that we had up in New Hampshire, in the mountains of New Hampshire in the spring, when I was looking forward to seeing Ernie anyway, because Ernie is a hoot. Plus,
yeah,
just being in his company, just being around him is fun. Everything moves fast. Everything about Ernie moves fast.
All three of those guys and me were all probably between age 50 and 55. Ernie has more energy than a teenager, and he does it day after day, year after year. I mean, he does that show 5 or 7 days a week, and you know, it's 2 or 3 hours, depending on which, you know, whether you're listening to the live version or the web version. And he doesn't stop talking during breaks. I mean, he talks during the commercials, he records that and puts it out. And he never lets up on that high level of energy. I don't know how he does it. I can't do that. I get mellow sometimes and have to be reflective.
I think I embarrassed my wife at Porkfest, because the first day of Porkfest, Ernie had just arrived, and I saw him in a distance walking towards us, and he waved, "Hey, Ben." And I went running out towards him, gave him a big hug and then took him by the hand, and we came skipping like two schoolgirls. We skipped all the way back to the group that I had been with. And I think my wife just kind of rolled her eyes and thought, I don't know who you are.
Yeah. Yeah. Bill and Ernie and Boston and I are kind of all the same subspecies of human male, which is, I call it theta, but I don't know if that's real. It's basically alphas that want to be left alone. You know, it's definitely all kind of alpha male, but without the traits of alpha male of trying to boss people around and trying to lead. You know, I mean, Boston is kind of a natural leader. I mean, and Bill was, you know, he was an officer in the army. He was leading. And both of those guys are so great with firearms that, you know, they can teach anybody something that they don't know already about firearms. But none of those guys or me try to, you know, surround ourselves with people and make declarations that have to be implemented. You know, we're all kind of like, yeah, if you're my friend, I'll hang out with you. But stay out of the spotlight, man. Yeah, I want to talk to the world, but I don't want to jump up and yell at everybody. And none of us have any problem with public speaking. But, you know, like, I don't try to do it. I try to avoid it. I did it with you last time I did it at Porkfest. It was fun.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. And Boston Tea Party, I know you've said this before, but he is a man's man. He's the kind of guy that goes to Africa and shoots giant animals and flies his own private plane wherever he wants to go.
And does mixed martial arts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, so does Bill Buford.
Yeah. All right. Well, that's enough of us kissing up to men of liberty, but they're men worth kissing up to, and we're not kissing up. We're just giving praise and praises to. We'll be back after this trip to the market.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends, and I'm beaming these words into your cerebellum. When you shop online, please do it through the Freedom Fiends Amazon link over on the right side of freedomfiends.com. It won't cost you any extra, and the Fiends will get a little taste from Amazon, and Amazon will save you the danger of drive-by stabbings at your local mall. Amazon sells pretty much everything you can buy on this earth, except for guns and weed. But they do sell the DVD Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. So get that for your gun-hating stoner brother or neocon gun nut dad. They'll thank you for it. That's freedomfiends.com. Freedom, Foxtrot, Echo, November, Sierra.com.
Hey, this is Nathan Explosion from Death Clock, and you're listening to Freedom Fiends on the radio. Worms.
This is the Freedom Fiends. This is Michael Dean. Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, is my co-host. And we're talking about the interview from yesterday with Boston Tea Party, Bill Buford, and Ernie Hancock. And I got to say, like, another thing I like about kind of some of the old guard guys is part of being a man's man is being able to hold your libertarian juices, being able to tipple some tasty beverages and still talk coherently. Whereas some of the new guard tipple some tasty beverages and then, like, show up at someone's house and threaten them with bear spray over a beef on Facebook, you know?
Yeah, very childish.
Yeah, that's not the... Oh, that guy blocked me today, too. That guy's one of those, can dish him out, but can't take him guys. He blocked me from commenting, even polite, feisty comments when he's out there just screeching at everybody. Yeah, I like the old breed that don't... Or I like the breed of liberty activists and liberty... Not even liberty activists. That's the thing. Like, the older guys, like, just spreading information and knowledge and ideas and teach something useful, like, you know, riflemanship. Whereas some of the new breed, or there's some of both of these in the older times and the newer times, you know, the newer people just seem to be like, look at me, look at me, look at me. You know, even with useful activism, like cocking a shotgun in DC and getting arrested for it. I mean, and I have a lot of admiration for Adam Kokesh for doing that, but it's still kind of like, look at me, you know, kind of stuff. And I'm not saying anything bad about that guy. I'm saying, like, that's kind of one of the really good examples of the new activism, of the internet, look at me activism. You know, the old guy, like, a lot of the new breed of liberty don't even know who Boston Tea Party is, because he's not on Facebook, man. He's not on the internet. You know, while everybody's sitting in their apartments drinking their coffee and beer and whiskey, yelling at each other and having petty beefs, unlike my beefs, which are not petty, having petty beefs, you know, the older crowd, the old school, the OG, the original gangsta, the original libertarians from back, you know, who were writing books about this like 15 years ago, when this new generation were largely like in short pants, you know, riding a tricycle, or, you know, were 18 and voting for Pelosi or something. You know, this new generation, the older generation is kind of more like, you know, when the new kids on the block are beefing on Facebook and posting feisty activism videos, the older crowd are like, you know, flying their private planes around the country and going hunting in Africa, you know, going on safari and things like that. And I have a lot more respect for that somehow.
I do too. I refer to this younger generation of activists as cheerleader libertarians, because they seem to, you know, they make a lot of noise on the sidelines and they're really, you know, flashing things around and there's a lot of activity going on. But the old guys were out there in the field actually, you know, figuring out new concepts and figuring out how things work. And you know, they were, to me anyway, reading an old Rothbard book or reading some of Boston Tea Party stuff. That's, you know, boots on the ground type stuff. That's not just jump around and clap your hands and try to say something rhythmically. And I don't mean that to insult the cheerleader libertarians. I suppose cheerleaders are an important thing. I never got the concept, but I suppose I'll take everybody else's word for it that it's important. But I've always appreciated the play on the field more than the cheerleaders myself.
Yeah, and I'm sure that to a lot of people, we sound like a couple old guys telling war stories and talking about how we need to get back to when things were good. But I'm all for going forward, and not in an Obama sense of forward progressivism, you know, destroy the old values that are even the good ones and replace them with redistribution of wealth. I'm not saying that, but I'm saying I think you need a foundation of history to go forward in a way that isn't just marching into the dark. And here's an example of it. The fact that there are people who don't know who Boston Tea Party is, it kind of reminds me of when I was playing music in the 80s and 90s. I was playing in this weird band called Bomb, which was kind of punk rock, but a lot more melodic and not really like anything else out there. A lot of the people I knew were playing metal, because that was the big thing then. And we didn't play metal because that wasn't our thing. But a lot of people were playing metal. And there are a lot of people that were playing metal that was influenced by Led Zeppelin. Like, everybody in every band liked Led Zeppelin back then. And you had to, you know, you had all their records and you knew all their licks on guitar and you'd played in cover bands. And that's kind of how you learned to play. That's not what I did, but that's how a lot of people, my friends, did to learn to play guitar. The thing is, a lot of the people, and that was a good basis for, you know, learning to play the new kind of metal, at the hair metal at the time. You kind of had to have the Led Zeppelin stuff on your belt. But then there were, like, Jimmy Page learned to play guitar listening to, like, Howlin Wolf, you know? And a lot of the people in the new metal bands didn't know who Howlin Wolf was. And you could tell because their music was only derivative of something that was derivative of Howlin' Wolf. So therefore it had no originality in it. And really and then there were people who like grew up listening to those hair metal bands that didn't even know who Led Zeppelin were, you know? So they had this totally polished kind of clinical, fake rebellion metal with a lot of makeup that didn't have any basis in anything older than, you know, Motley Crue at the best and Poison at the worst. You know, really, like, to tap the vein, you have to go back to the well, I would say. And I'm not saying great men need to be worshipped, but I'm saying if you're a libertarian and you're waving a gun around and you're open carrying and you're on the cop block and you're, you know, following the Cantwells and you're doing all the new internet Facebook stuff and you don't know who Boston Tea Party is and you haven't read his stuff, you are a hair metal band who's never even heard of Led Zeppelin, let alone Howlin' Wolf. And I would, are you laughing, Ben?
That is an excellent, yes, that's great. I love that.
And I would recommend that if you're one of these new libertarian Facebook activists who open carries, you should go read some books by Boston Tea Party, and you should read some books by Claire Wolfe, who is a contemporary. She's kind of like the old hippie grandma who carries a gun and was talking about maybe it's time to, you know, 15 years ago, you know, when all these Facebook activists were in short pants or voting for Nancy Pelosi, Claire Wolfe was writing books on gun technique, off the grid existence, and the stupidity of trying to change things through voting. And she's really funny and really sweet and has a lot of humanity in it. And she said 15 or 16 years ago, we're at an interesting time in American history. It's too late to change things by working in through the system and too early to shoot the bastards. And that is kind of a mind-blowing thought, especially 15 or 16 years ago, before any of this crop of internet activists had even, you know, read Rothbard. So, and a lot of these people have read Rothbard, but they skip the generation in between. You know, they maybe do know who Howlin' Wolf is, but they don't know who Led Zeppelin is, and they're playing hair metal. So, I think you need, I'm going to give people a homework assignment that they can ignore if they want. I think you should go read some of Boston Tea Party stuff, and I think you should read some of Claire Wolfe stuff.
Yeah, specifically Hologram of Liberty is really good by Boston Tea
Party. The thing is, there's a lot of his influence around the Liberty movement and by people who don't even know who he is. Like Chris Cantwell is heavily influenced by Larkin Rose, who is heavily influenced by Boston Tea Party. Larkin Rose has read everything by Boston Tea Party and internalized it and kind of made his own thing out of it. Chris Cantwell has internalized everything written by Larkin Rose and kind of like added a frat boy component to it and a look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me attitude to it. I don't even know if Cantwell knows who Boston Tea Party is.
Probably not. I'd be willing to bet that he doesn't know.
And people in Cop Block don't know. A lot of people, I mean, the founders of Cop Block know this. Cop Block is all based on a book by Boston Tea Party. It's called You and the Police. And I've never heard them say that, but it absolutely is. Everything that Cop Block does is enumerated in the book You and the Police. And that was the only book like that when it came out. And, you know, I know he's spoken places where the Cop Block founders were. You know, he's spoken at Porkfest. He's I've seen interviews with Pete Eyre where they're in front of a bookshelf and there's Boston's books on the bookshelf in back of him. It might be Ian Freeman's house, but, you know, Boston's books are there. So they're aware of him. And if you read the book, You and the Police, it is a blueprint for everything Cop Block does. And, it, you know, it came out 6 or 7 years before Cop Block started. And it basically, you know, it says, like, ask cops why they're pulling you over. Don't, you know, don't consent to a search in your car. Ask them what their probable cause is. Ask them, you know, all of the steps that Cop Block does. If to film the police. And this is like before this book came out, before, you know, every cell phone had a camera in it. He was like, get a video camera and keep it in your car. And that book is actually the book that took me to liberty, from being a statist to a minarchist in one sitting.
You know, I think there's a phenomenon that happens with people where they don't understand how something works, or they don't know how it works, or they haven't been taught how it works. And so they just almost naturally assume it's magic. You know, I don't know why when I flip this switch on the wall, the lights illuminate, and I don't know any aspect of how that takes place. It must be magic. And they don't actually make any effort to understand how electric works and how electrical appliances work. And, you know, and it's not necessary to a certain extent to know all those things. But there's this unfortunate tendency that humans have that if they don't know how something works, they make an assumption, and it may be horribly flawed. When I was in engineering, I was in aircraft engineering, worked for General Electric Aircraft Engines, which was a wonderful company to work for, as long as you're not on the receiving end of the bad part of that company. But as in that environment, I interacted with engineers, high-level engineers, on a daily basis. And one of the ways that you could really upset them was to say something or other about one of the new, you know, half-invisible, quiet airplanes that are flying out there, and say something about it being, you know, alien technology or whatever. Because these guys, they were the guys that actually sweated and toiled and spent endless nights working, and they created that. Those individual engineers built that. It was not something that somebody backward engineered, and we knew that because we were the ones that were actually figuring out how deep do these little grooves have to be to absorb amount of sound?
And people do that with statism too. Like they attribute things that the free market created to the government, to the magic of the government. And even libertarians and, you know, no government men are guilty of this too. When they do things like, yeah, cop lock invented this whole thing. No, Boston Tea Party invented it. You know?
Yeah. We need to know our roots and we need to know where these things come from. You know, Barack Obama said.
Yeah, we'll be back.
Listening to Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean and some of his weird friends. And yes, we're broadcasting this into space.
This show survives on donations from fiends like you. We put that money back into our show and Liberty Outreach and donate most our ad space to Liberty organizations that make a difference. We're also a teaching hospital, educating the next generation of Liberty Talkers on the skills needed to keep the radio flame of truth burning into the future. Put your money where your heart is and make a donation of any amount to the Freedom Fiends. Please go to freedomfiends.com and click on the spinning coin on any post.
Time for Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, to do his redemption in the third act. Go, Ben, go, Ben, go, Ben, go.
And this is a teaching hospital, so let me just point out that I was not watching my
clock.
The clock close enough, and I didn't. I started to bring up a whole new topic right as the.
I was trying to steer you away, kind of like, you know, you'd do with your drunken grandfather at Thanksgiving. You'd like steer him into the other room to go take a nap when he just starts ranting. And you're not drunk.
So, yeah. So I'll just close that topic out that, you know, Barack Obama had said, that we made that. In other words, society built that, or the government built that, or all of us did this together or whatever. But that really goes in the face of every individual who's ever sweated and toiled over a project and then brought that project to its completion. Everything, whether we're talking about the roads or whether we're talking about amazing aircraft that are flying around or whether we're talking about cars and the technology that's involved in those, individual humans spent their lives sometimes and put unbelievable amounts of labor and thought and effort into building these things. Individuals did this. There's no magic in society. There's no alien technology that we just, you know, got in the basket, as they say in movies where and in storytelling, where you just drop some magic thing out of nowhere and it solves all the problems. Life is not like that. We it's not the government that does these things. If it's good, if it's something that's in our society, it's something that we're utilizing, we're talking about the internet, we're talking about computers, we're talking about airplanes, it doesn't matter, the roads, whatever you're talking about, individuals sweated and thought and put their effort and risk their own lives and fortunes to develop these things. It was not the government and it was not society. There's a show on TV that I really like called Big Bang Theory, and in the intro and exit for it, there's some music really catchy.
Okay, I know what you're gonna say. There's a line in that song, "We built the pyramids." I always yell at the TV, like, "Wait, I didn't build." No, your slaves that died thousands of years ago built those. I didn't. Don't blame me for that.
Yeah, exactly. The pyramids and the
have we discussed this, or we just both came up with this?
I don't think we've ever talked about it before.
Yeah, we built the wall, the Great Wall of China, and we built the pyramids. Both were built by tyrants with slave labor. Don't include me in that we.
And they were a complete waste of money and effort and everything else. The pyramids were based on silly mythologies, and they cost... I did the math one time.
And that's because math is short for do the mathematics. The proper term is do the maths.
Yeah. I did the maths one time, and I compared the price of the Great Pyramid adjusted for the economy to modern day, what it would cost nowadays to do something like that. And it was about the same as an aircraft carrier cost, which is an unbelievable amount of money and is a good example of money that the government has wasted, because today an aircraft carrier is 60-year-old technology that was outdated about 45 years ago. But the government goes on making them anyway, wasting unbelievable amounts of money doing this. But each technology, each thing, it's not we, it's not they, it's not a group, it's individuals who had ideas and who followed through and developed those ideas into an invention or an innovation. And it's that kind of effort. And it's risking. Almost any technology that you can think of, lights, electricity, the automobile, computers, there were some individuals at some point in time took money out of their pockets or money out of their bank accounts and said, I believe in this idea and I'm risking this money that this idea will work. And in doing that, that's how we got electricity. That's how we got telephones and computers. Some mom in the Bay Area had to say, okay, boys, you can use the garage. Just don't set anything on fire while you're building your little computers.
Yeah.
And if it wasn't for that kind of risks taken, we would not have the computers that we have today.
Oh, yeah. Because if it weren't for those guys and that mom, you know, computers would be still the size of a floor on a university and take teams of scientists to run them and cost millions of dollars and be about as powerful as an iPhone is now. The free market, man. You built that. Well, you didn't unless you were involved in the free market, but the people in the free market built that. Thanks, Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker. It's been a great show.
Thank you, Michael.
Worms. Freedom Fiends.